I am.
Good morning. Morning, Corey. How are you, bud? By the way, this is interactive church, probably nothing like you've ever seen before, so feel free to talk back, okay? Just feel free to let's converse here, okay? Let's converse. Yeah, somebody will be talking back at some point, I'm sure. Man, we're so glad you're here. So glad you're here. We are in our fifth week of a series called You Are. And like we said before, for seven weeks, we looked at the book of John to see who Jesus said he was. He's the light of the world, the gate, the good shepherd. So many things he said. I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus knows very clearly who he is. But guess what? Jesus knows very clearly who you are too. And he's got some good words to say about that. The thing is, are you as sure about who you are as Jesus is about who you are? That's the thing. Satan loves to make you feel like trash. Satan loves to make you feel worthless. He loves to make you feel beat up. He loves to trick you and to just totally get you off track. Had a young man in my office the other day. I'll just share this with you. And again, this is who you are. And this is a testament to who you are. A young man came to my office Wednesday afternoon, just knocked on the door, didn't know him from Adam. And he said, I just need to talk to somebody. He said, I just buried my 5-year-old son. Long story short, and this is the way God works. He was trying to find a friend of his who lives out in this way somewhere. This young man was from Pennsylvania, and he had a friend here, and that's the only friend he had in Rock Hill. And he was trying to find him. And he went down here to the station and couldn't find his friend, so he was sitting in the car crying at the station right down here. And the lady from the gas station walked out and said, are you okay? He said, no, I'm not. He said, I just buried my 5-year-old baby. And he said, I don't have anybody to talk to. I'm by myself here. I don't have anybody to talk to. She said, well, I'm going to tell you what, there's a church just right up the road there. And she said, if you go up there, there'll be somebody there to love you. Guys, that's the difference you're making in this community. That's what's going on. That's the difference. It ain't Scott Carroll doing this. Y'all doing it. That's the difference. 2.5 hours we sat in there. He just poured his heart out. It's a whole long story. We'll talk more about it. In fact, he's going to be coming and sharing his testimony with us at one point. But it's amazing the way God works. God's sovereignty and his provision and his just the way he moves all the pieces together like that. But where I was going with that was he was sitting in the car up here. And he's a Christian. And he said, you know what? He said, but the devil began to tell me. And he said, these are the words that I heard in my head. If God loves you so much, why'd he kill your boy? And he said, Satan began to just throw that stuff up at me and throw that stuff up at me and throw that stuff up at me. And he said, but I told Satan he had no place in my life. That God didn't kill my boy. God loves my boy. And God is faithful regardless of whether my boy is here or not. And I thought, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Satan loves to just fill your mind with junk. Just junk. That's why Scripture says, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Renewing of your mind is taking what's in here and putting it in here. It's great that it's in this book, but guess what? If it stays in this book, what good is it? It's got to get in here and here. It's got to make a difference in your life. Amazing, amazing. So let's talk today. Who are you? Today, Jesus wants you to know this. Today, Jesus wants you to know that you are forgiven. Look at the person next to you and say, I'm forgiven. And if you don't believe me, ask Jesus. All right? Jesus said it. What do you think of when you hear the word forgiveness? Lots of different stuff pops up in my head. I know Usually, and I'm just going to be honest with you, usually in a human standpoint, when you're forgiving somebody, it's because you want to get something. You know, it's all about you. You can be real humble and say, I'm going to forgive you. But what you're really doing is just, you know, wanting something for yourself. Usually. That's the way that goes. But forgiveness, look at this. Look at this. This is from the Holman Bible Dictionary. It says, forgiveness is an act of God's grace to forever forget and not hold people of faith accountable for sins they confess. Somebody just better say, praise God to that. Hmm. To a lesser degree, the gracious human act of not holding wrong acts against a person. And that's the hard part. You know, it's easy for us to say, oh, Jesus forgave me. But my goodness, it's hard for us to not hold something against somebody else. Forgiveness is a gracious act of God. Gracious means we don't deserve it. We don't deserve it. We're not good enough for it. But it's a gracious act of God where, now stay with me now. This is very important. This is important stuff today. It's all important. But this is, you got to get this. You got to get this. It's a gracious act of God where believers are returned and put into a right relationship with God. Do you realize God created you to have an intimate relationship with Him? A personal relationship with Him? God is not, as Bette Midler says, from a distance. No. Uh-uh. Everybody used to be all jacked up about that song, and I thought, that's the worst song ever. A, she can't sing. B, that's the worst song I ever heard theologically. God is not looking at you from a distance. God is looking at you from inside your heart saying, please turn to me. Please turn to me. So we're put right into a right relationship with God. Now listen, we talked about this the very first week. And transferred from spiritual death to spiritual life. Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive. Remember, you were dead in your trespasses and sin. But God made you alive. And He did all of this, now stay with me, through the sacrifice of Jesus. Through the sacrifice of Jesus. Now, let's just be honest. Everybody need forgiveness. Everybody need forgiveness. Everybody does. And here's the thing. Our need for forgiveness goes all the way back to the first part of this book in Genesis 3, where Adam and Eve totally and willfully disobeyed God. You realize God put them in the Garden of Eden and He just walked with them and talked with them and fellowship with them. I just picture them sitting under a tree drinking sweet tea and eating hot dogs with slaw and chili. I mean, they were having just as awesome, you know? And they said, well, them slaw hot dogs is pretty good, but you know, there's that fruit of yonder from that tree that He said we shouldn't have, so why don't we go sneak up on that thing? And of course, the devil played his trick in there too, and then it all went to pot, okay? From the time of Adam and Eve, guys, Adam and Eve willfully disobeyed God by choosing to satisfy their own self-will. Ooh, that's what sin is. We willfully disobey God to satisfy our own self-will. I had a guy tell me 5 or 6 weeks ago, talking to him, he said, I know what God wants, but I know what I want, and this more. I thought, ooh, you need another cup of Starbucks, dude. It wasn't Starbucks, it was actually McDonald's down here. And here's the thing. The result of Adam and Eve's sin and the result of our sin is guilt. It's separation from God. It's a loss of fellowship with God and humans. And thanks to Adam and Eve, it's a life of hardship, anxiety, and death, all under the wrath of God. Now, the wrath of God, that's going to be another sermon for us. But here's what I don't want you to go out of here thinking. I grew up being afraid of God. I grew up afraid of God's wrath. I thought God was somebody that was going to just zap me. If I did something wrong, I just thought, God's just going to just bust me. Listen, God's wrath is real, but God's love is realer. And guess what? God's wrath was satisfied on the cross with Jesus. God's love is never satisfied. Never satisfied. But there's good news. Turn in your Bibles or turn them on to Ephesians 1. We were in Ephesians a couple of weeks ago. Very first sermon in this series. Looking at Ephesians 1, verse 7 and 8. And we'll just read this, and then we'll break it down a little bit. Reading from the NIV version today. In Him we have redemption through His blood. Every word of this is important, so stay with me. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace that He lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. Forgiveness of our sins. Paul uses two words in this to talk about, to describe the relationship to sin and what we need, and what our needs are, first of all, and that's redemption and forgiveness. To be forgiven is to be set free from any guilt or consequences from your past sin. Now, we'll talk about these consequences in a minute. Don't hear what I didn't say there. Okay? But when you're forgiven, you're set free from that. It's like just the chains are broken off of you. It's like to have your sin slate totally wiped clean. And we're going to talk about this more in just a minute. But let's do this. Okay? Clean slate, right? All right. Okay? Scott's sin. Scripture says, come let us reason together. Even though your sins are like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. And even though they are red as crimson, they will be like wool. Forgiveness means to have my sin slate wiped clean. So we're going to talk more about that in just a minute. And you can't really see this, but you know what? If you look hard enough, you can still see Scott's sin on that. Okay, if you look hard enough. We'll talk more about that in just a minute. But the thing is, that's exactly what happened. Your sin slate was wiped clean. I believe God's word. It is written. Even though your sins are like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. In other words, he's saying, I don't care what you did. What I did is bigger. I don't care what you have done. What I did for you covers all that. It covers it all. Sin in the Bible, sin is regarded as like a state of slavery that's the result of your transgressions, your sin, and that evilness. Listen, here's the thing, and let's just be straight. Guys, we commit sin because we are sinners. The Bible says, for all have sinned. What part of all is not all? For all have sinned. Okay, that's everybody. We're born with a sinful nature. And the very fact that we do things that are sinful just highlights the fact that we're sinners. And because a lot of times we call it a sinful want to, okay? A sinful want to. Because each of us were born with this sinful want to, and each of us commits sin, then we are all in need of forgiveness. There's nobody who is naturally good and without sin. Everybody is in need of God's salvation and forgiveness so that we will not have to experience that spiritual consequences of sin. Let's look at the before and the after. Before, our state with before receiving God's forgiveness is quite frankly this. We're living in sin, and the end result of that is eternal death. After we receive God's forgiveness, This is what we are. We are living not in sin, but in the righteousness of Jesus. And we are not looking at eternal death, we're looking at eternal life. And like we've said before, don't be confused that eternal life starts the moment you die. Your eternal life starts the moment you became a Christ follower. So don't miss out on all that God has for you there. So by the power of His Holy Spirit, important words, by the power of His Holy Spirit, God lives inside of us and He lives out His life through us. So every believer is a walking picture of before and after shot. Okay? Before and after. Before Christ, we were unforgiven and we were straight on that path to death. After Christ came into our lives, we're forgiven and we're on the path to life. So let's break this verse down just real quickly and break it up. All right? First thing he says is, in Him we have redemption through His blood. Redemption. That means we're set free from bondage. We're liberated. Okay? We're delivered. To be redeemed means that you're delivered by the payment of a debt. All right? Now, redemption by its very nature is the purchase of something that has a debt against it. Listen, we see this all the time. You go down to Teague's Pawn Shop. I buy stuff there all the time. Okay? That's the way pawn shops work. Everything in that pawn shop has a debt against it. Okay? And if I buy something in there, I'm buying a piece of equipment or something that has a debt against it. So I'm redeeming it, so to speak. Back in the 70s, I never forget, a friend of mine owned a pawn shop, a friend of Daddy's owned a pawn shop, called me up and he said, you know anything about a Les Paul guitar? I said, I believe I do. He said, well, I got one, a boy pawned it, and he can't pay the debt for it. He said, if you pay the debt, you can have it. So I said, absolutely. So I paid him the $50 debt and got me a 1958 Les Paul Jr. Bam! I was excited. But see the point? The guy needed money, so he hocked his guitar, and then he could not pay the debt. Somebody else came along and paid the debt and took the guitar out of debt. You hocked your soul. You couldn't pay the debt. Somebody else came along in the name of Jesus Christ and paid the debt. Now, the only thing that would make this actually scriptural is if I had known who the person was who guitar it belonged to, and I took it to him, I said, here's your guitar back. But selfishly, I'm glad I didn't know who that was. But see what I'm saying? Do you see how that works? That's redeemed. That is redeemed. Okay? And here's the thing. Guys, you and I as sinners, we carry a debt of sin. In our sinful state, we are in hock to Satan. We are in pawn to Satan. It's a death sentence. But when Jesus died on the cross, guys, He paid our pawn ticket. He paid you to redeem you. He purchased you for God. And Paul here, it's very, very clear to understand this. Paul talks about in this passage, he talks about our redemption as something that has already taken place. Guys, we have redemption. You don't have to hope for redemption. You have it as a Christ follower. Listen to what Paul says in Colossians. Colossians is a lot of times called the parallel book to Ephesians. But look at what he says. It's going to come up on the board, I think. He rescued us from the domain of darkness. So He rescued us. And then He transferred us into the kingdom of the Son He loves. We have redemption, the forgiveness of sins in Him. That's what happened when you became a Christ follower. Okay? Paul was reminding these Colossians that you're not saved by how much you know, how many times you go to church, how much money you give, how many habitat houses you build, or whether you're included in some secret religious cult or not. That don't have nothing to do with it. You are saved solely by the blood of Jesus Christ and God's grace, period. That's it. Okay? Through Christ and Christ alone are we redeemed and we have that forgiveness of sin. Think of it like this. If we want to be freed from those, from that consequences of our sin, a huge, tremendous price had to be paid. But the good news is we don't have to pay it. Jesus paid it. Remember that song, Jesus paid it all? All to him I owe. Sin hath left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus, our substitute, has already redeemed us by his death on the cross. And our part is simply to trust him and accept him. What if I had gone to that guy at pawn and gave him my $50 and he's handed me the guitar and I was like, nah. That'd be dumb, wouldn't it? Jesus paid our pawn ticket, purchased us for God, and so many of us go, I appreciate it, but no. All you have to do is accept it. Just accept it. We trust him. We accept it. Your sins have been paid for. And the way, the path has been totally cleared to restore that relationship with God. It's in Jesus that we have this redemption that Paul talks about. Because, now listen, because when we believed in Jesus Christ, we became redeemed. In Old Testament times, y'all know I was studying through Leviticus there for a while in my quiet time until I got saved and got out of that. It was I went through the whole book actually. Crazy stuff, man. But anyway, it talks about the sacrificial system. In the old times, that word redeemed meant to be set free from slavery or set free from prison. A lot of times they called it a ransom. It meant buying a person's freedom and giving. And Jesus is the one that buys our freedom. Romans 3:24 says, we are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. So we praise Jesus just consistently. We have that. And when we have that redemption, we are freed. We are set free as prisoners from sin, from addiction, from guilt, from shame, from injustice, from marginalization, and all of that stuff. And just like Paul said in Romans, God has done the work of rescuing us, or to the Colossians, I mean, transferring us from the kingdom of into the kingdom of the beloved. That would be Jesus. That Paul says it came at a cost, and I've got to keep hitting on this, guys. It came at a cost, and that cost was the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, that was the sacrificial death. Revelation 1:5 says that Jesus loved us and set us free from our sins by his blood. Guys, it might have been free, but it wasn't cheap. Jesus literally took mine and your place on the cross, and he took with him on the cross all of our sins, all of our sicknesses, all of our vileness, all of everything. He took that with him on the cross. 1 Peter says, you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by the tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish and without spot. So basically, you are redeemed. As a Christ follower, you are redeemed. Second thing he talks about is forgiveness. Look at the next part of that verse. The forgiveness of sin. Paul says that redemption is linked to the forgiveness of sin, so you can only find forgiveness of sin in Jesus. And again, our redemption was costly. Our forgiveness is costly. Through his death, Jesus set us free from our slavery to sin and gave us forgiveness of sin. So here's what happens. When we believe in Christ, an exchange takes place. All right? We give Christ our sin, and he gives us redemption and forgiveness. Okay? Our sin was poured onto him at the crucifixion, and his righteousness was poured onto us at our conversion. Scripture says that that God's forgiveness means that he doesn't even remember our sin anymore. Some of us have spent years begging God to forgive us for a sin, and God's like, I ain't got a clue what you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about, but you just need to move on. God forgives and he forgets. Ooh, that's something we don't do, is it? Maybe we might forgive him, but boy, we won't forget. Guys, listen. Your sins are completely forgiven. Boom, completely. Scripture says, it is written, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We just said that. And then listen to what he says, 1 John. This is what John says. If we say we have no sins, we're fooling ourselves. Okay? The truth is not, we're liars. If we say we have not sinned, then we make God a liar. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Listen, Jesus gave his blood for you to cover your sin. Now, if I had some way of doing this without making a huge mess, I would do it. Listen, our sin slate is wiped clean. Remember I said you can see a little bit of that on there? Jesus' blood just covers it. Jesus' blood just covers it. And as I was talking about a while ago, in one of the things in the Leviticus study I was doing, the Old Testament believers were told that you symbolically transfer your sin to an animal and then you sacrifice it. So the animal died in your place. You put your sin on that animal, and that animal pays for your sin, and then that allowed them to continue living in God's favor. God directed that. God spent a whole chapter in the Bible telling them how to do that. And God forgives them because of their faith in him and because of their obedience to him through that sacrifice. Okay? But here's the thing. The whole book of Leviticus, the whole Bible is in anticipation of the final sacrifice, the once-for-all sacrifice, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. It's pointing toward Jesus, and thank God we don't have to kill all them goats and bulls and doves and stuff no more. I don't know about you, but I sure wouldn't want to be a preacher if I had to be cutting stuff up out here in the front and throwing blood on you. You read that book of Leviticus. That's the dirty business. But it's because God is a holy God, and sin has to be dealt with. So Jesus became that final and ultimate sacrifice. So if you know about it, they would have to bring an unblemished lamb. Now, first of all, I think about that when I look out in the back at our goats. I don't even know if our goats, I don't even know if I could find an unblemished goat. Them's ugly goats. My goats are ugly. Cindy's are beautiful. All right? But I'm telling you, I mean, you know, you bring them goats, they got mud all over them and stuff all over them and everything. I'm thinking, well, does the mud count as a blemish? How do you keep a goat or a lamb from getting dirty? I don't know. But that's what God required. So here's the thing. So instead of an unblemished lamb, a perfect lamb being killed on the altar, the perfect Lamb of God was killed on a cross. A sinless sacrifice so that my sin and your sin could be forgiven once and for all. Anybody that believes in Christ experiences redemption and has forgiveness of their sin. Now, just as an aside, remember the story in the Bible where Jesus is having lunch with these guys and this woman comes in and pours this real expensive perfume all over him. And of course, the preacher's there going, oh, how dare she? You know, how dare she? They grumbled about it. And Jesus said, look, this lady realized how much she was forgiven. And people who are forgiven a lot love a lot. And people who don't realize how much they have forgiven don't worship and love Jesus like this. Okay? I love this passage in Psalms. David said, Lord, if you kept a record of our sins, who, O Lord, could even survive? But look at the next part. But thank goodness you offer forgiveness. And so, in living in this identity of who we are, we've been called to do three things. And those things are, first, forgive other people. That's hard to do, I know. We're to share God's message of forgiveness. And then we are to walk as forgiven saints in Christ Jesus. Guys, we are to live every day as forgiven saints. We've talked about this before. You're not just a sinner saved by grace, as good as that song is. You are a saint. You are a saint. Walking as a saint, we walk boldly into that life God has prepared for us by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that means true repentance. Remember, we've talked about what repentance is. I do this all the time, but I just got to get it in your head. Repentance is you're marching down the field this way toward death and hell or whatever it may be, and the band director, heavenly band director, says to the rear march, and you turn around this way, and you're marching toward God and everything He has for you. Now, some of us are going, no, True forgiveness. You turn from that toward God. Okay? So our identity is no longer in that loneliness and sin and guilt and shame and death. Our identity is in life and joy and peace and love and eternal life. We walk as saints, as children of God. And he goes on to say, this is in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Jesus' sacrifice paid the price and bought your redemption and forgiveness. And as crazy as it sounds, God's grace, that whole thing is an expression of God's generosity. The fact that God killed his own son for you is an expression of his generosity. And grace, man, what a word. Amazing grace. It says, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. Now think about this. Not only did it say he gave us grace, it said he lavished it on us. He poured it on us. He showered it on us. And God wants to give you that grace. He wants to give it lavishly. He wants to just pour it all over you. I watched a boy the other day in the Waffle House. Little fella. I'll tell you what. They had to get 3 bottles of syrup for that kid. He lavished syrup on his waffle. I mean, it was like all over it. Guys, that's what Jesus does for you with his grace and his forgiveness. He pours it on. He pours it all over you. And then notice what he says, with all wisdom and understanding. A lot of people misread this verse. A lot of people says that was God's wisdom and understanding. God did it because he had all the wisdom and understanding. No, what it says is he gave you the wisdom and understanding. He gave you the wisdom and understanding to walk in the Christ life, to walk in the God life, to walk in the Jesus life by grace with that wisdom and understanding. Wisdom in this word right here, the Greek literally means to see things from God's perspective. Man, don't you want to see that? God gave it to you. He allows you to see things from his perspective. And understanding simply means insight. You got that secret wisdom to sort of discern what's right and what's wrong. Wisdom and understanding are given to us along with redemption and forgiveness and grace. Listen, we're going to wrap this up. When God forgives, he totally forgives. He forgives it completely. He forgives it. And Scripture says he forgets it. There ain't one shred of evidence left over. There ain't no leftover. He don't have to get a doggy bag. There are no leftovers in your forgiveness. Period. And it never runs out. And the great thing about this is, nobody who is truly seeking God's forgiveness is going to be turned away. It's for everybody. And our part is this. First of all, we come to God with a humble heart and we confess the fact that we're sinners and we can't do this on our own and we need help. In 12-step programs, that's the first thing you have to do is admit that you need help. That's the first thing you have to do is to become a Christian. You admit that you need help. You confess it. And then you accept Jesus' sacrifice on that cross as for you personally. And then you receive that forgiveness that God has to offer. And God's response to our confession is always to forgive. You don't have to worry about that. You know, and here's the thing. Are you living today with the knowledge that you are fully redeemed and fully forgiven? If not, then what's the problem? Do you have that identity of somebody who's been set free from bondage? Do you really feel that? You know, a lot of people today, especially, you know, Christians will say, well, you know, yeah, I've been forgiven, but they kind of say it with a question mark in their voice, like kind of like, I hope I've been forgiven. Guys, you don't have to hope. You can know beyond a shadow of a doubt. And others will say, well, yeah, I've been forgiven, but I just keep struggling with this sin, and I wonder if that means if I keep struggling with that sin, that God never forgave me for that sin or whatever. Guys, that's Satan pouring junk into you. The biggest question is we have to accept God's total forgiveness, forgive ourselves, and move forward. Put down that stick you're beating yourself up with and move forward. If you hang on, listen, if you hang on to all your guilt and shame, then you're just spitting on what Jesus did on the cross. Now, there's still going to be consequences for sin, okay? But guess what? God can even redeem the consequences. You're not required to live with the guilt and the shame and regret. You can hold your head high and walk into your future. Accept your past mistakes and understand, okay, that's put me in the situation I'm in, but then acknowledge that God's forgiveness is greater than any of that. You are forgiven by God, and I do not have to let my past mistakes play into my future. Listen, you got two choices. You can either make history or you can make excuses. Stop making excuses. Start making history. It's written in God's word, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Romans 8:1, there is now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And in John 8:36, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Listen, guys, if God's forgiven you, He's telling you to forgive other people, forgive yourself, and then open yourself up to walk in the God life that He planned for you. As Jordan's coming up, I want just to pray right here real quick. This may be your prayer. Lord, cover my past with Your forgiveness. I confess I need You. I confess I'm a sinner. I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe that You died personally for me on the cross. And I believe that my sin was put on You and Your righteousness was given to me. God, I want to start fresh right now. God, revolutionize my today and change my tomorrows. In Jesus' name. I don't know what God's telling you to do, but for some of you, it might help if you just come up here and you might want to write something like my sin, and then take this and just erase it, and then thank God that even though your sins were like scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Let's stand.